I do want to thank everybody for coming. I appreciate your love and your dedication to my dad being here for all these years. And I thought, well, instead of doing a funeral service for my dad, why not celebrate his life and not his passing? As you can see, Dad was pretty much of an avid 49er fan. When my dad lost his leg, my mom and I were very, very concerned about him, thinking that, oh, you know, it was good because my dad loved walking, he loved fishing and everything else. Walked into the ICU, he was recovering from that. My dad's laughing with the nurse. He said, I'm going to try out for the 49ers as a kicker, but they only told me I had one good leg to stand on. He goes, pom, pom. So we knew Dad was going to be fine.
Yeah.
Then when Mom passed away 11 years ago, last March, I thought, well, maybe get Dad closer to me, but then I'm seeing how much everybody in this community really, really, truly loved my dad and really took care of him. And I knew this would be the spot for him, because I know he'd be looked after with friends, adopted family, adopted grandkids, and second generation grandkids. So it's been something else. Some of the stories that he's told you about him being in the war and whatnot, there's a couple of stories that probably none of you know when he was in the military. There was two gold boxers that came to do an exposition or to a demonstration for boxing on their base. And my dad was telling, he says, I could beat them with one hand.
Gold gloves.
And so it got through around the barracks about my dad bragging that he could beat these guys. So they set up a meeting with one of the boxers. It lasted within 2 minutes. My dad took the first punch, or the guy took a punch at my dad, missed my dad, my dad went in an uppercut, and unfortunately, the man died before he even hit the ground. My dad broke his neck with one hit to the guy's jaw. So a lot of you know how strong my dad's arms were.
It was two hits, him hitting him and him hitting the ground, huh?
Yeah, he's a character. He always had that up. He always liked talking about the war stories and whatnot of things that he's done. And you know, and I lost him when I was a little kid. My mom divorced him. They had to get a divorce, and I had a stepfather growing up. And at the age of 13, he came back into my life. And I didn't know who this guy was, and then I found out, well, this was my true father. So he would come on a couple of weekends and visit, and we'd talk and everything. So he says, okay, well, I'm going to take you fishing next weekend. Okay, that's fine. I wasn't that much of an avid fisherman. I like the ocean fishing better than I like it over here. So I was kind of looking forward to it. He never showed up. Couldn't find him. Never showed up. We didn't have a phone number to contact him because he didn't have a phone. The address we had, but we didn't have. So we moved, and we were in Newman at the time. Moved another place in Newman. Moved from Newman to Turlock. Went to junior high school and high school, wondering whatever happened to my dad. Went into the service, came out of the service, so I hired a private detective to find my dad. He found him the first day. So he gave me the address, I went over there and knocked on the door, and this was in Modesto. And I'm talking to him, we're just talking away, and I'm telling him about the fishing trip way back when. Then it finally dawned on him, he says, oh my God, you're my son! So he thought it was some, you know.
Yeah.
And from 1978 to present, that's how long I've had him back in my life. My mom was in the hospital, and I told my dad about it. He went to see her. He talked to her about Lake Tahoe. My mom's heart meter was they were monitoring her heart. Every time my dad would say Lake Tahoe, so So the doctor, so the doctor told my mom she was underneath a lot of stress. She had to get rid of some of the stress in her life. So my mom went to my stepfather and says, Harry, doctors told me I have a lot of stress in my life and I have to get rid of it, and you're most of it. So she left my stepfather and went back to my real father.
Cool.
Talk about a story for any kid to have of having their true parents back, which is, couldn't ask for anything better. They moved here in 81. They've been here ever since. I just disconnected the phone. So it's been, that same phone number's been here since 81. So he's been here a long time. He has seen a lot of history throughout this park. And the thing that was really interesting, as some of you know, but where I had my dad cremated at French Camp in 99, the cemetery there, his parents are both buried there. Talk about a full circle. And they lived here in French Camp a long time ago. So that was something else. I really don't have too much more to say. A lot of you know about all the stories that he's talked about. A good friend of mine, Brian Taylor, who came from back east and performed along with me in Modesto for a major event for one of John Denver's organizations called Planet 2000. He did a song, and it's underneath the markings of a tombstone that says, Do not stand at my grave and weep. And there's a little saying that was on this thing. So he made it into a song, and he put more words to it. And I like to dedicate this song to my dad.
Stand at my grave and weep. I am not there. I do not sleep. Just take with you my memory, and I shall live on. Just think of all the dreams we share, the times we had a care. And what I've left with you somewhere is a smile in your heart. And know that I had a great life. I enjoyed so much each day. Made almost all my dreams come true some way. Do not stand at my grave and cry. I am not there, for now I fly. My spirit soars like an eagle high. Lives within your soul. So once again, do not stand at my grave and weep, for I am not there, and I do not sleep. Always take with you my memory. Now live on.